the aspect of affairs now became serious. The disaffected miners formed themselves into corps, elected their leaders, and commenced drilling. They possessed themselves of all the arms and ammunition which were within their reach. All cause for doubt as to their real intention from this moment disappeared. A riot was rapidly growing into a revolution.
It was certainly a revolution. No riot begins with such a dignified and glorious and infusing, heartwarming statement.
We swear by the flag of the Southern Cross to stand truly by each other and fight to defend our rights and liberties.
Well, the word revolution is more often used of something that's successful, like the Russian Revolution and the American Revolution. In some ways, it was successful, but in military terms, it was a failure, an abject failure.
Only once in our history have Australians stood under opposing flags and faced each other on a field of battle. In one single time and place, we cut each other down with muskets and bayonets, bringing death at point-blank range. The time was 1854, and the place was the Ballarat Goldfields in the new colony of Victoria. After the battle, the rebel leaders were charged with high treason. If found guilty, they could hang. Their fate would be in the hands of a jury that had to decide whether the Eureka Stockade was a riot or a revolution. There are very few photographs of Victoria at the time of Eureka. People drew and wrote about their world. The Canadian Douglas Haigu was a civil servant working in the goldfields administration at Ballarat. In his retirement, he wrote an account of Eureka based on his personal diaries.
Let me say that somehow I find myself clinging with a sort of fondness to the old picture. For there was an indescribable charm about the rough, unceremonious life of those early days, with their strong vitality and rapidly occurring incidents, strange and exciting as those of a romance, which enshrines it as an experience apart.
A gold digger who left an eyewitness account was the educated and flamboyant Italian Raffaello Carboni. The language of these writers tells us that they saw themselves as actors in a great drama.
I was an actor, and therefore an eyewitness. The events I relate, I did see them pass before me. The persons I speak of, I know them face to face. The words I quote, I did hear them with my own ears. Others may know more or less than I. I mean to tell all that I know, and nothing more.
Carboni became one of the leaders of the Eureka Rebellion. His subsequent trial was a turning point in the fortunes of the governor back in Melbourne. Sir Charles Hotham was Victoria's second governor. He had a distinguished naval career behind him and was ambitious to become an admiral. Hotham had wanted the command of a ship, not a colonial government.
I endeavored to convince both His Grace and the Prime Minister that a better selection might, without any difficulty, be made. Failing in those quarters, I prayed to be sent back to Argentina. Here also I failed, and notwithstanding my entire conviction that the government were mistaken, I had either to decline serving the public or comply with their wishes. Thus placed, I accepted the latter alternative and with a sorrowful heart go to Victoria.
Thank you.
In March 1854, Hotham embarked on the three-month journey to Victoria. At about the same time, Céleste de Chabrillon, wife of the new French consul, was arriving.
We enter Port Phillip Bay at midday. From a distance, the view is glorious. The coastline is fresh and green like new hope. Huh? The harbor like a forest of masts.
Céleste and her husband were joined by thousands of new immigrants, pouring into a colony in the grip of change. For nearly two decades, Victoria had been a small pastoral district, governed from Sydney. It had only become a separate colony in July 1851, with Melbourne its capital. In the same month, gold was discovered, turning this sleepy outpost of empire upside down.
Well, in the space of a couple of years, Melbourne became the largest city in Australia, ripped past Sydney and remained the largest for the next half century. It became the port for the richest goldfield the world had ever seen. The people started pouring in sailing ships from Britain, France, Germany, China.
They were young, they were mostly male, and they saw this as a great opportunity. And when groups of 12, pulled out £6,000 each from a hole, people were just astonished. And here, all sorts of ordinary people are going to be given that chance to gain their independence. It really is freewheeling small capitalism.
By the time Céleste de Chabrillon arrived, the gold rush in Victoria was in full swing. Her observations of the colony were as colourful as the life she had led in Paris as a courtesan and dancer.
We cross Main Street of Melbourne. It looks just like a fairground, except that the shopkeepers are not dealing in gingerbread, but in gold. They are almost ape men, these shopkeepers who stand beside their open-air shops, grimacing and contorting their bodies to attract the attention of successful miners and to buy their gold. Everything happens as if by magic. Today you see a plane, a week later, it's a village. The gold fields, which are fortunately a fair distance from Melbourne, are frightful to behold. They are like colonies of moles digging their holes. Such deep holes that pits excavated without any forethought cave in and bury those who built them. The women work like the men, and the children likewise. There is not an idler to be seen. Gold obsesses them, fascinates them. They hope to find tomorrow what they failed to find the day before.
In just 3 years, the population of Victoria had gone from 80,000 to 300,000. The influx brought people of different races, religion, and politics. Nothing like this had been seen in the previous 60 years of white settlement in Australia.
There was a sense that the whole place was disrupted. The world had gone mad.
Here were all these people rushing to the goldfields, leaving the wharves, leaving the schools, leaving the building sites, leaving the hospitals, all determined to get to the goldfields. It was a crisis.
It was a crisis that had to be managed. When the new governor arrived on the 21st of June, 1854, he found a colony on the edge of bankruptcy.
In England, shortly after I had received the appointment of governor, the Secretary of State took up the financial estimates of this colony and, handing them to me, said, "This, Sir Charles, is the difficulty you have got to face. There is an enormously extravagant expenditure going on in that colony, which, if not arrested, will cause its ruin.
Victoria was full of seasoned political brawlers. The merchants and squatters controlled the legislature and used their power to resist much-needed reforms. The colonial bureaucracy was bloated and untouchable. The diggers had a growing list of grievances.
The new colonists are restless and discontented, either openly or behind the scenes. They want laws, they want reforms, they assemble. Meetings and banquets follow and increase every day. Ah, there is talk. All these soapbox orators think they are Mirabeau.
Everyone wanted more spending on services and infrastructure. No one wanted to pay for it. Determined to balance the books, Hotham decided it was time for austerity measures. He would set the example.
The whole town and countryside were in a state of wild excitement. The governor is to give a ball. Everyone was looking forward to a wonderful time. All the men could think about was the lavish supper to which they intended doing full justice. They rushed forward in a crush. They trampled each other underfoot. But what a disappointment was in store for them. On the sideboard were a few cold meats entirely surrounded by nothing but hams. And the only drink available? A keg of colonial beer. If it's true that the governor is very sensitive to criticism, he must be most unhappy and bitterly regret holding what they now call the beer ball.
Soon after his arrival, Hotham went on a fact-finding and goodwill tour of the goldfields.
I proceeded in the first instance to Ballarat.
Ballarat had been a sheep run and was the resting place of the Aboriginal people, the Wathaurong people. That's what the word Ballarat means, resting place by the beautiful swamp. And this was the very area that all of these gold immigrants came to by the end of 1851.
Some of Hotham's advisers referred to gold diggers as wandering vagons, a transient and dangerous population with no stake in the future of the colony. But Hotham was pleased with what he saw.
I found an orderly, well-conducted people, particular in their observance of the Sunday, living generally in tents, having amongst them a large proportion of women and children. Schools of every denomination and people of every nation are on the diggings, and there was an appearance of tranquility and confidence which would reflect honour on any community.
Three cheers for the governor!
Hotham's trip was a great success. He saw no serious problems, and the diggers thought they had met a man who was listening.
A bold, vigorous and far-seeing man has been amongst us. And the many grievances and useless restrictions by which a digger's success is impeded will be swept away.
Others were more realistic about both the governor and the administration.
Truth constrains it to be said that Sir Charles Hotham was not the kind of man to give proper development to the nascent energies of a colony circumstanced as this was.
Douglas Highgew was a keen observer. He watched events unfolding from inside the government camp at Ballarat. The camp was set high on the ridge and looked down into the river valley swarming with diggers. It housed the Goldfields Administration, known as the Gold Commission. Highgew understood the growing tension between the commission and the diggers.
A principal cause of the unpopularity of the Gold Commission was doubtless owing to the silly attempt at its formation to make it aristocratic and exclusive. The mud-besplattered and blunt-spoken diggers did not like to have riding in amongst their claims at all hours individuals tricked out with scraps of braid and gold lace, and often redolent of perfume.
There's a sense of the camp looking down on the diggers from the position of people for whom trade in the British gentry classes was a dirty word, and believing that they're a sort of mob and a rabble grovelling in the dirt for filthy lucre.
The result was that every goldfield in the colony possessed a population hostile to the authorities.
Simmering hostility found a voice in diggers like Raffaello Carboni. He became a favorite speaker at meetings on the Ballarat goldfields.
We must meet as in old Europe. Old style, for the redress of grievances inflicted on us, not by crowned heads, but blockheads, aristocratical incapables who never did a day's work in their life.
It's a great conflict between ideas of how the world ought to operate. Should it be a gentry kind of well-organized, you know, really a feudal approach in a capitalist situation? And this to me is the nub of the conflict that was emerging at Ballarat.
When the first gold diggers arrived in Ballarat in 1851, a lot of the gold was shallow. They'd dig a hole maybe a metre down and there was gold. By 1854, in certain parts of Ballarat, especially around Eureka, they were putting down shafts 50 metres deep.
The deep sinkings needed at Ballarat meant that diggers had to put in months of labour with little or no return. As more found it harder to survive, discontent grew. The biggest grievance was against the gold licence, which all miners had to purchase, whether they found gold or not. The revenue barely covered the cost of the gold commission.
The administration of the goldfields proved an extremely expensive thing for the government. This tier of government that's imposed with these gold-laced commissioners, the gentry of England who came out and were given these very well-paid jobs as gold commissioners and magistrates on the goldfields.
Most government revenue was raised through indirect taxes, primarily import duties. There were no taxes on income. The gold license was a new kind of tax, a direct tax on people's labour, and they didn't like it. On his trip to the Bendigo goldfields, Hotham addressed a crowd of 8,000 diggers, calling for it to be abolished.
You ask me to do a very serious thing. To do away with a large portion of public revenue. We must all pay something, and I will endeavor to make the taxes as light as possible. I will give the subject every consideration, but having made up my mind as to what is right, I am just the boy to stick to it.
The previous governor, Charles Latrobe, had tried to introduce an export duty on gold. Only successful miners would have paid the tax. Seeing it as the thin edge of the wedge, the squatters and merchants killed it off. With protest growing, Latrobe halved the license fee. The cost became £2 for 3 months, about the price of a pair of diggers' boots.
The world had very little experience of running a large-scale free goldfield. I mean, California was the first on any scale in the whole world, and that was only found in 1848. Then come the Australian goldfields in 1851. It's still a very new, a very difficult administrative task. They had no precedents to learn from.
This was the system Hotham inherited. He knew it needed fixing, but that would take time, and time was running out. Increasing numbers of diggers were avoiding the license, exacerbating the colony's financial problems. And for Hotham, an even bigger issue was at stake.
So long the law, however obnoxious and unpopular it may be, remains in force, obedience must be rendered or government is at an end.
After Hotham's tour of the goldfields, expectations were raised that he would abolish the gold license. He did the opposite, ordering license checks up from once a month to twice a week.
The executive was doubtless induced to adopt this course in the interests of law and order. But no greater mistake could have been made. The notorious practice of searching for unlicensed miners with an armed force was termed the Digger Hunt.
Were dispatched like bloodhounds in all directions to beat the bush. Anyone who in old England went fox hunting can understand the detestable sport we had then on the gold fields of Victoria.
The digger hunts were mostly carried out by the newly formed police forces. They included many ex-convicts from Tasmania, which had recently changed its name from Van Diemen's Land. There was no love lost between the diggers and these Vandemonians, as they liked to call them.
Get a tolerable young pig. Make it stand on his hind legs. Put on its head a cap trimmed with a gold lace. Whitewash its snout, and there you have the ass in the form of a pig. I mean to say a policeman.
There's a sense in which the hard-working population has lost faith in the people who are organising them. And after the stepping up of the licence hunts, things start to go badly wrong.
The situation only needed a spark to explode. It came on the 7th of October, 1854.
Two men, older friends named Scobie and Martin, after many years' separation, happened to meet each other in a Ballarat. They call in at the Eureka Hotel on their way home, intending to have a finishing glass. They knock at the door and are refused admittance. They proceed on their way, not perhaps without the usual colonial salutations. At about 50 yards from the hotel, they hear a noise behind them and retrace their steps. They are met by persons unknown who inflict blows on them, which render one insensible and the other lifeless.
Witnesses claimed they saw Scobie attacked by the hotel owner, James Bentley. He was one of the despised Vandemonians, and his hotel was seen as a hangout for corrupt officials and police. Bentley was arrested and brought to trial. He was acquitted by a police magistrate who arranged Bentley's hotel license and was later sacked by Hotham.
When the bench found Bentley not guilty, when he patently was implicated in the death of Scobie, this caused the blood of the diggers to boil.
A large crowd of angry diggers gathered outside Bentley's Eureka Hotel.
Ripe for mischief and incited by inflammatory harangue, they gathered tumultuously about the hotel, took possession of a range of buildings, and commenced to demolish the windows and woodwork.
A cry of fire is raised. A horse shies and causes a commotion. Smoke is seen to issue from one of the rooms of the ground floor. Police try to extinguish the flames, but it's too late. Hip hip hurrah is the universal shout. The entire diggers are in a state of extreme excitement. The diggers are lords and masters of Ballarat, and the prestige of the camp is gone forever.
Soldiers remained as quiet spectators during these proceedings. The general feeling amongst us was that had those in command made prompt use of the force at hand, the hotel might have been saved. And of more serious importance was that a check would have been thus given to the most unscrupulous of the disaffected, whose avowed design was to cause an open rupture with the government.
The man in charge of the troops was the Ballarat Goldfields Commissioner, Robert Reed.
And Reed is stained by that. He's lost control of his field. He's got to prove to the governor that he's still to be reckoned with.
The riot at Bentley's hotel was a wake-up call to Hotham. For the first time, the diggers had used physical force. He ordered a new trial for Bentley and also arrested three alleged ringleaders of the riot. Events were now moving fast. Within weeks of the burning down of Bentley's hotel, a large protest meeting was held on Bakery Hill. The Ballarat Reform League was born. A charter of claims was drawn up that went beyond the abolition of the gold license. The diggers wanted access to the farming lands controlled by the squatters. And they wanted the vote.
Here were large numbers of miners who'd never voted in their lives. Many of them had never addressed a public meeting or a crowd in their lives. And here they were gathering together and setting up a very articulate and often very justified protest movement.
Hotham was under increasing pressure to act. He set up a commission of inquiry to look into all aspects of the goldfields administration.
This commission will inquire into everything and everybody, high and low, rich and poor, and you have only to come forward and state your grievances, and in what relates to me, they shall be redressed.
Bentley was found guilty of the manslaughter of James Scobie and sentenced to 3 years hard labor. The ringleaders of the riot were also found guilty and given minimum sentences ranging from 3 to 6 months. The Reform League was incensed. A deputation was set up to meet the governor. They debated a crucial issue. Would they petition or demand the release of the prisoners? They chose to demand, carried by a single vote.
Here's the Ballarat mining population coming with a demand. So the language is a very different language. And in fact, there's a threat that's implied, and that is that if the administration doesn't listen to the legitimate demands of the diggers, then they will seek to overthrow the prerogative of the government and replace it with the royal prerogative of the people. This is very much a republican threat.
The deputation from the Ballarat Reform League met with Hotham on Monday, the 27th of November. They were a week away from insurrection. It was the last chance for peace, but demanding the release of the prisoners was a stumbling block.
You are absolutely taking the law into your own hands. You are setting aside the most important principle of the British Constitution. I cannot depart from the verdict of the jury.
If Hotham had given in to popular demands, calling for him to take no notice of a jury decision, Hotham, when the news reached London, would have been in very bad favour.
The deputation pressed Hotham on a range of other grievances, the most important being the issue of representation.
Responsible government was well on the way and was being introduced at the time of Eureka.
The new Victorian constitution, which would give the diggers the vote, had in fact been sent to London 8 months earlier. Its passage through the British Parliament had been delayed by the Crimean War.
The new constitution is but a question of 4 or 5 months, and you may depend upon it that the government will be compelled by the nature of things to put the digger in that position which, in my judgment, he ought to be in. If the new constitution passes, a new state of things exists here.
Hotham's promises about the future fell on deaf ears. The diggers just wanted their mates out of jail. The deputation was going back to Ballarat empty-handed. Hotham ordered reinforcements to be sent. They arrived at dusk on Tuesday, the 28th of November. The next day, the deputation addressed another mass meeting on Bakery Hill.
There was a very strong split that occurred in the Ballarat Reform League.
On one side were the moderates, the Moral Force faction, led by the Welsh lawyer and chartist John Humphrey.
Mr. Humphrey calmly made us understand that Sir Charles was with us and was determined to put an end to our grievances. Three hearty cheers were given for the new charmer governor. amid the discharging of several guns and pistols.
I believed in Mr. Rumfrey and was at all his meetings round the stump, where he advised us all to go home and keep quiet. Well, I and my mates did so, and I'm quite certain if all hands had taken the wise counsels of Mr. Rumfrey, it would have been of much advantage to those present.
On the other side were the supporters of men like Timothy Hayes, an Irishman who rejected moral force in favor of physical force.
Timothy Hayes spoke like a man as follows. Gentlemen, should any member of the League be dragged to the lockup for not having the license, will 4,000 of you volunteer to march up to the camp and open the lockup to liberate the man? Yes, yes! The clamor was really deafening. Are you ready to die? Shout out our worthy chairman, stretching forth his right hand, clenched all the while. Are you ready to die? Yes! Yes! Hurrah!
Designing orators and anarchists were enabled to play upon the feelings of the miners and work them to the pitch they'd long desired, and the cry of abolish the license fee united an amount of sympathy and gave them a command of physical force which they could not otherwise have procured. No doubt the masses confined themselves to this one point, not so the leaders. Nothing short of the overthrow of the government would have satisfied them. And a march on Melbourne would have been the result of victory.
I marched in single file with the others at the Bakery Hill Maiden and burnt my license. We discovered afterwards that some of the Conninghorns burnt their old licenses and kept the ones currently in use, but we destroyed the genuine ones.
The Goldfields Commissioner at Ballarat, Robert Reed, still smarting from his humiliation at the riot at Bentley's Hotel, was determined to confront the diggers.
I am convinced the welfare of the state depends on the crushing of this movement. I propose sending out for unlicensed miners tomorrow in the usual way. This will test the feelings of the people.
Reed's license hunt got the desired result. Shots were fired. Prisoners were taken, and the Goldfields were left in uproar.
The heated blood of the diggers was not allowed to cool after this last raid, for within an hour, the rebel flag was hoisted on a tall staff on Bakery Hill, in full view of the camp.
About 500 armed men gathered under the flag of the Southern Cross. At the vital moment, the leadership mysteriously went missing, and the previously unknown Peter Lawler stepped forward. Lawler was a recent immigrant who came from an Irish Catholic family steeped in the nationalist struggle. His father had opposed the payment of land taxes, and his oldest brother fought in the failed uprising of 1848.
The family was a family that had thought about government and oppression, had thought about government and just taxation, had thought about issues of representation, and had thought about armed rebellion.
We swear by the flag of the Southern Cross to stand truly by each other and fight to defend our rights and liberties.
500 right hands stretched towards the flag. The vividness of double the number of eyes, electrified by the magnetism of the Southern Cross, was one of those grand sights, such as are recorded only in the histories of the Crusader in Palestine.
After the swearing of the oath, the rebels marched off to the Eureka diggings where they built a stockade. They started drilling and preparing military plans.
One mustn't walk away from the romance that's attached to the idea of a stockade and a raised flag and men together, a garrison of noble souls.
In 1848, a revolutionary ferment was in the air, and many of the major cities in Europe had had a series of revolutions. And it's fair to say that some of the people on Ballarat, and they tended to become leaders, had revolutionary intentions. They were a very small minority, although in the end, I think they were influential.
I went up to Lam, and at the moment he saw me, he took me by the hand, saying, I want you, senor. Tell these gentlemen, if they cannot provide themselves with firearms, let each of them procure a piece of steel, 5 or 6 inches long, attached to a pole. And that will pierce the tyrants' hearts.
They didn't know what they were doing. They're just so angry at the way they've been treated and the way they continue to be treated that they rushed to the stockade.
Once the stockade was built, life on the Ballarat goldfields was paralyzed. Food was running out. Law and order was breaking down.
Bands of marauders infested the outskirts of the goldfield, rendering travel unsafe. The assistant gold commissioner came in some days previous, his life being threatened by the mob. A crisis was approaching, and desired, in fact, for the situation had become intolerable. For several nights, none of us had undressed, and indeed scarcely slept at all. The alarms were so perpetual.
By the evening of Saturday, the 2nd of December, there were 1,500 armed men in the stockade. But during the night, most of them left.
Only about 120 men were in the enclosure. By what cause and by whose orders the others had left, I cannot say.
Some believed the government would not attack on the Sabbath. Others had a change of heart. Some just got drunk. Meanwhile, a force of nearly 300 soldiers and police was preparing to attack.
An ominous and oppressive silence brooded over the deserted workings. The people seemed in awe of some impending calamity.
There is a glamour to blood amongst people who have not fully experienced its horrors, that there is a sense to which blood consecrates.
My dear Alicia, should I fall, I beseech you by your love for me to shed but a single tear on the grave of one who died in the cause of honor and liberty. And then forget me until we meet in heaven. Farewell.
Gone down, and the stars were twinkling coldly in the gray of approaching dawn, while not a breath stirred. Our eyes were strained eagerly toward the Eureka workings, away beyond the valley and immersed in the shade of Warren Heath, the pyramidal mountain which cut the horizon to the east. When a single shot was heard, telling us that there was a real collision at last and that the turning point had arrived. Point of attack was well defended by the rebels, and their fire as simultaneous as that of drilled troops. Its severity caused the Queen's infantry to waver, and many of them held back, especially the raw recruits, who were mere boys.
On discovering the smallness of our numbers, we would have retreated, but it was then too late, as almost immediately the military poured in volleys of musketry, which was a plain intimation we must sell our lives as dearly as we could.
Be quiet!
Here begins a foul deed.
John!
Worthy of the devils, and devils they were.
John!
The accursed troopers were now within the stockade.
Many insurgents, outnumbered and unable to retreat, were literally butchered by the troops when they broke into the stockade.
Was horrible.
Innocent as well as guilty was shot down or saved. In the first heat of the conflict, few prisoners were made, and it was a scene of indiscriminate slaughter. And thus, within 20 minutes, the entire space within the stockade was in possession of the troops.
What a horrible sight! All the quaintances, crippled with shots, the gore protruding from the bayonet wounds, the coats and flesh burning all the while. The tears are choking my eyes. I cannot speak further.
Men generally, when let loose upon an enemy, are not angels. And after having been subjected for so long a period to the taunts, jeers, and insulting epithets of the miners, they should not be greatly blamed if, when chance offered, they somewhat exceeded the bounds of humanity in wiping out the score.
My thanks. And the thanks of all the well-disposed of this community are due to the officers and men of that small band. They crushed an extensive plot. They proved that masses are not to be dreaded where discipline and military confidence prevail.
About 30 diggers had been killed and many more wounded. The exact numbers are not known, because no official list of the dead and wounded was ever compiled. Peter Lawler had managed to escape and was in hiding. Seriously wounded in the shoulder, his arm was later amputated. 5 soldiers were killed and 12 wounded. About 120 people were taken prisoner, but most were soon released. Within days, 6,000 citizens of Melbourne gathered outside St. Paul's Cathedral to protest against Hotham and the government. Similar demonstrations sprang up around the colony. Hotham ignored advice and pushed ahead with the charges of high treason against 13 ringleaders. Carboni was the first to be tried.
Gentlemen, on the Saturday you find them behind a stockade, consisting of a few slabs thrown up in a few hours. Does that show you an intention of deposing Her Majesty from her royal crown and dignity? Does it not rather show you that it was the people resisting aggression upon them in the shape of digger hunting? You may make it a riot. If it was, then I tell you that this is not high treason.
The jury was persuaded that Eureka was more a riot than a revolution. It pronounced Carboni not guilty.
So transparent was the determination of the jury that after Raffaello's acquittal, it became a subject for discussion whether the trial should be proceeded with. It was urged that justice was held up to derision and mockery, and it would be most prudent to desist. But in this opinion, I could not share. If juries would not do their duty, I could discover no reason why I should not do mine.
Hotham pressed on with the other trials. One by one, the juries refused to convict. With public opinion against him, he was forced to grant a general amnesty to the Eureka rebels in hiding.
Once the trials had failed to get the convictions that really would have justified what he'd done, and once the Melbourne people had pilloried him for what had happened at Eureka, he was lost. And that loneliness of office would have been very destructive.
In March 1855, Hotham's Commission of Inquiry into the Goldfields handed down its findings. The hated license was replaced by a miner's right, costing only £1 a year. Revenue lost would be made up through an export duty on gold. The inquiry also recommended that the Goldfields Commission should be entirely abolished.
As soon as the Gold Commission was removed, they ran their own society with great skill, and Ballarat became almost a model urban community.
In a brief space, confidence began to be restored, and the whole diggings appeared to be invested with new life. The rattle of the windlass was again heard, and the old motley throng poured unceasingly along the thoroughfares.
Diggers over the Ballarat, get the book about the Eureka Stockade, written by the man who was there who saw it all happen, Raffaello Carboni.
Carboni returned to the goldfields to find all his belongings had been stolen. On the first anniversary of Eureka, he was out selling his eyewitness account at the site of the stockade. Carboni then returned to Italy. In November 1855, two giant steps towards democracy were taken. Victoria's new constitution had finally arrived and was officially proclaimed. But it would take another year to organize the elections for the new parliament. So an interim government was formed. Diggers holding a miner's right were now qualified to vote, and they jumped at the chance. They elected John Humphrey and Peter Lawler. Lawler went on to a glittering political career, holding several ministries and later becoming speaker.
It was like the incongruity of a dream, to see one on whom only a few months back a price was set, now sauntering quietly along the streets with all the aplomb of a senator, conspicuous by his empty sleeve. And to mark how the fussy politicians of the hour plied him with insidious doses of the aura popularis, impelled by a patriotic sense of favors in reserve.
Within a year of the Eureka Stockade, Lawler said that perhaps Eureka had been rather rash. It was probably the constitutional reforms which gave him the feeling this society is flexible and it can be worked by constitutional means.
On the day the new constitution was proclaimed, Hotham returned from the celebrations and wrote a dispatch to the colonial office. He said that his health was suffering and he wished to hand in his resignation.
There's some suggestion that Hotham is becoming slightly mentally unhinged. That might be too strong a word for it, but he's certainly under great emotional pressure.
I have had tirades of abuse. But I have stood firm. I've settled the gold question and obtained from an export duty a revenue of £300,000 per annum. In short, I have settled everything but the land question, which is too long and sorry to explain. And I shall hand over the government to a responsible ministry under the new constitution in a capital condition. It annoys me to hear this government, who've done their best to thwart and oppose me, now comparing our state with that of New South Wales and the colonies and saying how superior in every way it is, when I found them in disorder, unable to extricate themselves, and was in point of fact sent here because only a straightforward sailor would tackle them without favour, fear or affection. It is a vile hole, and I shall never like it.
On the 31st of December, 1855, Hotham sank into a coma and died. It was 2 weeks before his 50th birthday, and barely a year after the Eureka Stockade.
An honest man and an Englishman came to Victoria to make the crooked straight. But wanting the sympathetic eye, he could not see his likeness anywhere. And so he failed.
I think Hotham was sensitive enough to know that the new age that was coming in Victoria wasn't something that he could understand.
Moreover, another famous discovery was made. Namely, that instead of the government squabbling with the people, it was far better to let them squabble amongst themselves. Hence the creation of local courts, mining boards, and municipalities on the goldfields, which, besides their proper purposes, served as useful vents for the surplus energy of the crowd, while the general undercurrent of progress rolled on regardless of surface straws and eddies, nourishing healthy organization.
Every political party at some time or other has claimed Eureka as a special shrine, a special lamp. After all, conservatives can say, well, here's a protest by ordinary people at unjust taxation. People far on the left can say people had to resort to arms to get justice. We applaud that. All kinds of messages can be plucked out of that one dramatic and exciting event.
What it seems to me is worth emphasizing is that Eureka was the birthplace of social democracy. The community has a catharsis, and the energy of the people takes them forward to believe in themselves. And it senses that the right to rule of the gentry types has been discredited.
I can understand some people saying that the anniversary of Eureka Stockade should be our national day. Many of them would no doubt see the raising of the Republican flag as a pivotal event in Australian history, and maybe if we do become a republic, Eureka will have more significance. But we've got one of the oldest democracies in the world, and it's based on government by debate, government by discussion. We shouldn't be too keen on remembering an event which put the emphasis on government by force.
I think we're lucky that most of us have never been put in a situation in our lives in Australia where we believe that physical force is the only answer. We are fortunate in that there always seems an answer that is constitutional to our major problems, and for that reason alone, we're a blessed nation.
All the players felt that they'd been sold up the river by the administrators.
From trials and tribulations.
There was definitely, from 1960,
an idea that players with illegal actions had to be eliminated from the game.
No ball.
On to fun and celebrations.
Bill Lowry ran out of the room laughing that much, he couldn't move.
And I can assure you, we had quite a bit of Verve Clicko that night to celebrate.
Cricket in the 60s, 9:20 Tuesday.
He's out!
We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Join Maggie and Simon as they prepare a Christmas feast.
You don't have to wait for Christmas for this, do you?
Full of old favourites.
I've got parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme.
Oh, that's Christmassy. That?
And the odd surprise.
It shouldn't work, Maggie, but it's a stroke of genius.
The cook and the chef.
It's kind of jolly, isn't it?
6:30 Wednesday, ABC.
Two new albums celebrating the glories of the human voice. ABC Classic FM Choir of the Year, including all six state finalists and Choir of the Year, Birralee Blokes. And a two CD collection of best loved recordings from the divine Yvonne Kenny. The divine Yvonne Kenny and Choir of the Year, CDs available now from ABC shops, ABC centres, retailers and online.
Two comedy legends.
A toilet humour has its place, of course.
In the toilet.
But their lives...
This is ridiculous.
...were no laughing matter.
You have never, not for one moment, valued me.
Tonight.
Is there anything you're not good at?
Failure.
An outrageous premiere.
What, you constantly belittle me?
Starring Reese Evans.
He is incapable of human feeling.
The true story of Peter Cook and Dudley Moore. Not only, but always.
Finished.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Oh! 9:05 tonight. ABC.
Tonight at the movies, James Bond's first mission with Casino Royale.
Philip K. Dick's visionary paranoia piece makes it to the big screen, A Scanner Darkly.
And Lars von Trier is up to his old tricks with Mandalay.
Good evening.
Hi.
We also look back at an Australian film pioneer with Hunt Angels.
And documentarian George Gittoes picks up from where Soundtrack to War left off with his latest, Rampage.
But first, Margaret will get things underway.
I certainly will. Let's go to the latest in what must surely be the longest-running franchise in cinema history, the Bond films. It's Casino Royale with British actor Daniel Craig as James Bond at the start of his career, earning his 00 status at the beginning of the film in stark monochrome. And then the action begins. The chase is on. It seems that the banker to so-called freedom fighters, a.k.a. terrorists, is one Le Chiffre, played by the Danish actor Mads Mikkelsen. He's invested his clients' funds riskily. Needing to recoup $150 million, this mathematics genius decides to gamble all on a high-stakes poker game at the Casino Royale in Montenegro. Against Bond, of course. Bond is funded by the British Treasury to the tune of £15 million. The delivery person and holder of the purse strings is Vesper Lind, Eva Green. She is not your classic bikini-clad Bond woman, but she's a babe.
£10 million was wired to your account in Montenegro, with a contingency for five more if I deem it a prudent investment. I suppose you've given some thought to the notion that if you lose, our government will have directly financed terrorism.
This is a much more serious Bond than we've seen in many years. Daniel Craig inhabits the dark side of the secret agent really well. He's absolutely the best Bond since Connery. There are a few tongue-in-cheek moments, but there's no real sense of self-conscious spoof. The action scenes are excitingly staged by director Martin Campbell, maybe a bit too prolonged, as is the film itself at nearly 2.5 hours running time. My one quibble with the film is the casting of Eva Green as Vespa. She's gorgeous to look at, but not totally convincing as a performer. David.
I thought she was fine.
Oh, you're just swayed by a pretty face, David.
No, I like talent too, and I think she's got talent. But no, I think it's interesting, this Bond film, because first of all, there's no Q, and there's no Money Penny, and there's really no wisecracks. Or there's a couple of jokes, but not too many. And so it's a very different, as you say, a very different tone. But what I found really intriguing was this is the second film of the first book, and the first one was a spoof in the 60s. But this goes to the trouble of showing Bond becoming a 00 agent by killing someone. Now, so why do that at this late stage of the game? I couldn't quite see the point in including that, given that we're in a world of mobile phones and surveillance things, all sorts of high-tech, super high-tech stuff. It just seemed an odd kind of way to start the film to me.
Except that normally with a Bond film, you get this sort of like wonderful, exhilarating chase.
At the beginning,
the beginning of the film. And this is sort of like this really dark, ugly little moment in his life.
In black and white,
Yeah.
That's right.
I thought it was an interesting way to start.
And interesting, too, is the way they use the Bond theme, the music. Because there are little hints of it through the film.
Yes.
It really only comes into its own at the end. I think this is a very intelligent film for a Bond film, and certainly one of the most enjoyable in some
And Daniel part. Craig is exceedingly sexy. I do feel I've got to say that.
I thought he was, I don't know about sexy, but I thought he was pretty effective. So I'm giving it 4.
So am I, 4 stars.
I'm Mr. Arlington Beach, professional gambler, and you're Miss Stephanie Broadchest, heiress.
I am not.
You're going to have to trust me on this.
Oh, no, I don't.
We've been involved for quite a while. Hence the shared suite.
But my family is strict Roman Catholic, so for appearance's sake, it'll be a 2-bedroom suite.
I do hate it when religion comes between us.
Religion and a securely locked door. Am I going to have a problem with you, Bond?
No, don't worry. You're not my type.
Smart?
Single.
Casino Royale will open absolutely everywhere in Australia next week. And now to A Scanner Darkly. In 8 years' time, it seems, America's war on drugs has become linked with its war on terror. Bob Arctor, Keanu Reeves, is a reluctant undercover cop who's ordered to spy on his friends. They include Jim Barris, Robert Downey Jr.
Anyone entering the house while we are gone today will receive a little surprise, a little something I perfected early this morning.
What kind of surprise? It's my house, Jim. You should ask me before you start wiring up my house.
His other friends include Ernie Luckman, Woody Harrelson, and Donna Hawthorne, Winona Ryder.
Well, that's weird. I didn't know you could get an 18-speed bike nearly new for $50. It's amazing what you can get for $50. I'll give you 60 right now, no questions asked.
You know, this bike looks a lot like the bike that this girl lives across the street from me had that got ripped off about a month ago. This bike could be hot. They probably jacked it, these hoister friends of yours.
Sure they did. I mean, if they've got 4 and selling it that cheap.
Right? You should at least show it to her so she can see if it's hers.
Yeah. Okay, I can do that, but this is the boy's bike, okay? So it can't be, not to...